Hello, everyone, and welcome to Fabric Tech Talk Fridays. I'm your host, Patrick LeBlanc, and today I have Dr. Dax with me, Mr. Phil Seamark. Phil.
Hey, Patrick. Thanks. Very nice to be here.
Yeah. So before we get into all this stuff, sure. Why don't you tell the people who you are and what you do?
Okay, so my name's Phil Seamark. I work on the Azure Fabric CAT team, and I specialize in DAX and data modeling. So I get the opportunity to work on some pretty interesting DAX problems.
Yeah.
Typically with big data, lots of users, all that sort of thing.
So recently I heard, you and I talked about this, and we talked to some other people about this, that you're working on a really, really important project internally.
Yeah, so inside Microsoft, periodically, we've got a really important report that needs to go out to a lot of people.
Yep.
You know, we've got over 200,000 people at Microsoft, okay? And when you send in a report that a lot of people are interested in and want to open it at the same time, that creates pressure on the system,
yep.
Okay? So what we wanted to know is the system going to handle it?
Yep.
So I worked with a very small team on this report, and the critical element that we really needed to figure out was how was this report going to perform under load. So we developed a load test tool. In previous years, we've done this other ways.
Sure.
There's some really good load test tools out there, PowerShell based. Often you have to spin up a VM, etc. But we wanted to use the world's best end-to-end BI platform, Fabric.
All right, because it's the center of the universe.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I had a chat to a really clever colleague of ours, David Brown.
Yeah,
and,
hello, David.
Yep, and between us, we wanted to figure out, could we actually use Fabric to load test Fabric? Yeah. There's some elegance in there, isn't there?
So before we go too far,
yes.
You keep saying load.
Yes.
What does it mean? You know, if I have a piece of software or an application, what does it mean to put it under load?
Okay, so inevitably when you're running some queries and you're the only person on the system, you know, hopefully they're going to run pretty well, okay?
Yep.
But what a lot of people forget is what happens when 10 people try to run, you know, open the report at the same time. What happens when 100 people, and in our case, we were going to be sending this email out to over 20,000 people.
Wow.
Okay, so what happens? How is the server going to respond? So you kind of want to know ahead of time. And importantly, when it's under load, which parts are going well, which parts are running maybe slower, because they allow you to focus on what to optimize, okay? And of course, things like row-level security comes into play as well.
Right.
And a lot of people forget this as well.
Okay. All right, Phil. So this is great. Having this conversation with you is great, but I don't want to talk anymore. Let's take a look at what you did.
Okay. So the solution we came up with was using a Fabric notebook.
Yep.
And the benefit of using a Fabric notebook is it's right there next to your Fabric semantic model.
Yep.
And importantly, you have the ability to spin up multiple threads. So I've got an example here that I can show you what it looks like.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Okay. So I have a workspace here, and in my workspace, I have a semantic model. Let's just pretend this is the semantic model. I want to see how it works under pressure. Now, what I need to do, first of all, is capture some queries.
Sure.
So I can download perhaps the report that's associated with that, the one that the end users are going to be opening. And I can download that to my Power BI desktop, for example, and turn on Performance Analyzer, just click around, capture real-life queries, for example.
And if you're not familiar with Performance Analyzer, there's lots of great videos and content out there that you can go check out.
Yep. And now that once I've got these queries, I put them into the files section of a lakehouse because, hey, we're working with Fabric, everything's going to go into a lakehouse.
So I need to create a lakehouse.
Yep, you definitely need a lakehouse.
And then I would upload that JSON document into the file section of that lakehouse.
Correct. So if I open this particular lakehouse, you know, you have tables. We're not using tables, we're just using files. So in my files, I have the DAX queries. So this JSON file is the Performance Analyzer real life set of queries.
Yep.
And you could replace them. You can have multiple sets of these, for example. And plus I have an area for logs. So when the load test is running and when it's complete, I've got something that I can go back and do some analytics of over.
And these queries should represent what's actually going to happen on the report when my report consumers are running these, right? And that's what this JSON file gives us.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Now, what I also have in this workspace, and it doesn't all have to be in the same workspace, this is just for demo purposes.
Yep.
I have two notebooks.
Okay.
Now, one of my notebooks is a control notebook. So this notebook here is where I can go in and set some parameters, like where is the query file that we want to open and replay, for example. How many times do I want to iterate through these? How many parallel threads do I want to have running at any particular time? And this is where load comes in.
Ah, okay.
So what we did was, initially, I sort of started with 4 parallel threads and seemed to go all right.
Sure.
And I went with 50. Yeah, that's pretty good. Mm-hmm. Then I went with 400. And this was really putting pressure under the system. And one thing you do need to do with a notebook is potentially configure it to say, hey, I want to use X number of cores rather than the default, because the more threads you do, the more CPU you need. Yeah. But that's all there in Fabric, you know, so that was pretty easy to do. So we've got in here some parameters like, how many concurrent threads do I want to run?
Okay. And so is this synonymous with the number of people?
Now, a lot of people make this mistake, because it depends. It is always depends. But the load test is going to rapid fire queries, a lot of queries against the system, but it'll give you a consistent pattern. So if I was to run my load test multiple times using the same parameters, I should expect to get very similar behavior.
Sure.
Now that gives me the opportunity to obviously study the results, and I might go in and change my model, optimize something, fix a piece of DAX, and fix the model, for example. And if I replay the load test tool using the same parameters, I can see whether it's better, worse, or the same. Yeah. And actually, load test tool shouldn't just be getting, you know, preparation for maybe a big launch, for example. I would highly recommend it becomes part of your application lifecycle management, so that just as you're doing CI/CD, you're going from dev to test to product, et cetera, you know, there's no reason why you can't just fire up the test and make sure that whatever change you may have been making is going to certainly not make it worse.
Yeah, it doesn't kill the system. Right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Yep.
But I'm going to show you how this works. I'm going to change this concurrent thread to say 5, and I'm going to click it off. I'm going to click the play button, and it's as easy as that. So behind the scenes, this Fabric pure Python notebook, sort of it sits on a VM. Mm-hmm. What that's going to do is call the second notebook that comes with this set, and it's going to run it multiple times. So underneath here, because I've said I want to run 5 threads, we can see these 5 threads here. Now what they're doing is each one of these is opening the JSON, the query file, and potentially running it as a different user. So you can configure this to say, hey, one of these users is Phil, one of these users is Patrick, one of these users is someone else, for example. And that is, again, something that does get forgotten about, unfortunately, a little bit, but this handles this. You just create a file with email addresses, which you can, which you grab out of the Azure portal, for example. And look, this one's nearly done. It's iterating the query file 3 times.
Yeah.
And it's storing the results, such as how many rows got returned by each query, and the query time. And it's going to put that into the file section of the Lakehouse, which, hey, you can then put into Power BI and do your analytics. Have a look at things like query times. So as I mentioned, you know, we did this. This gave us confidence with the internal report. We sent it out. And I'll tell you a little bit about the setup. So what we did, because there were so many people, was we spun up 4 Fabric capacities. These were F128s.
Okay.
And we put 4 copies of the semantic model, but like manual query scale out.
Yeah.
Scale out like what I get it when I get too much food, for example.
Or me.
And we sent emails to, 5,000 people got, were directed to one capacity, one workspace.
Sure.
These 5,000 went to this one, for example. So that sort of spread the load, which was kind of nice. Now, because we'd load tested it, we had the opportunity to really optimize this. And actually, one other point, we also ran the load test over the version of the same report from previous year. So we could see straight away that the this year's version of the same report was already performing, 200 times more efficiently.
So, but on the back end, so you had these 4 capacities.
Yes.
You obviously set up like scale out and other optimizations.
Oh, we did have the ability to scale up if we needed to. And I'll show you some numbers because these are pretty cool numbers. Where is my load test? Cool. All right. So let's put that into full screen. So over a 48-hour period, we received 1.53 million queries. At peak, we were receiving 5,100 queries per minute. So that's about 90 queries per second.
Wow.
Now, across the whole 48 hours, the average query time for all those 1.5 million queries was just 111 milliseconds. So a fraction of a second.
Less than half a second.
Less than half a second.
Truly a fraction of a second.
The P99. So 99% of all of those 1.5 million DAX queries completed in 623 milliseconds or less.
Easily less than a second. Yep. Easily less than a second.
So we got, there were no reports of anyone having problems opening the...
Really?
And also, we didn't get close to one capacity got up to 80%, but did not need to throttle.
So no throttling at all.
And we did have the ability to need to scale up if we needed to, but we used the other fabric capacity tools to watch this. It was quite exciting. We had the fingers over the button ready to scale up if we needed to, but we didn't. We could see the peak load go up and then go down. And then what we were able to do fairly quickly after the first 48 hours was delete those capacities, throw them away, put the data set back onto a pretty standard F64. And everyone was really happy. Everyone was really satisfied. And I can't underestimate the role the load testing took. The key is a lot of people underestimate the value of doing good load testing, not just for prepping, but also just ongoing to make sure that it runs pretty well.
So three things here.
Sure.
Three things that I got, right? You should definitely make this part of your software or application development lifecycle. You absolutely need to do that. Number two, this takes into account role level security, which most people always
don't do well. Yeah.
Right? They don't do well with it. And this is an iterative process. So when I make changes, I go check to make sure it's not negatively affecting what I'm doing with my semantic model, right? So you just keep kind of going through this.
And the elegance of this particular solution is all you need is two notebooks.
That's it.
You can create your own like SaaS. If you've got Fabric, there's no extra charge, no extra cost. You can just configure a workspace. You can point it to as many semantic models as you like.
Yeah.
You can run it as many times as you like. You can do whatever you like with the logs, etc.
Yep. And so, okay, Phil, now that we know that this is truly successful and how you all have taken it to another level, how do I get my hands on this?
I thought you might ask that. So what we're going to do is we're going to put the notebooks in a GitHub repository called Fabric CAT Tools. There's a whole bunch of existing tools in there getting maintained and updated all the time. So if you want to have a play with this, there'll be instructions. Download the two notebooks. Feel free to contribute and we can make it better.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Phil, for taking time out of your busy day. I know you got a lot going on. If you all have any questions about this load test tool or just some questions about Dax, you know what to do. Post it in the comments below. Phil's going to answer them all. All right. If this is your first time visiting the Fabric YouTube channel, be sure to hit that subscribe button. If you like this video, big thumbs up. As always, from Phil and myself, thanks for watching. We'll see you next Friday.
Thank you, everyone, for watching. If you found this video valuable, don't forget to hit that like button.
If this is your first time visiting the Microsoft Fabric YouTube channel, be sure to smash that subscribe button.
Drop a comment below on what you would like to see on the future episodes of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays.
That's it for today. See you all next Friday for another deep dive into Microsoft Fabric.